Last time I have forgotten to say something. This is a small thing, but still it needs to be said. The definition of a partial lift. Tends to A as X tends to X0 or same definition, but different gods, or that the limit of epsilon greater than zero, there exists delta greater than zero such that for any x from deleted delta neighborhood of x zero, it follows that f of x is from a neighborhood size epsilon of A. Very important bit. This neighborhood is deleted, their neighborhood is not.
Epsilon, not delta.
Once again?
In this neighborhood, not epsilon, but delta.
This is delta, this is epsilon.
Okay.
I remind you, so here I maybe should have written it more explicitly, right? Let me fix it a bit. So, I said it tends to A. I want to be explicit and say that A is a real number or infinity. Actually, we will broaden a bit more this set of things that A can be, sort of symbols. But for now, let's have it just extended real number. And x0 is also from the extended real life. If x0 is a finite number, then this expression we could write here like x minus x0 absolute value is less than delta but greater than zero. So I remind you that this deleted neighborhood is just a neighborhood without the middle point itself. So x minus x0, the distance from x to x0, should be less than delta, so it is inside neighborhood. But it should x should not equal to x0. So this distance should be greater than it. Okay? And similarly, over here we can write that if A is a finite number, then f of x is minus A to the value of the rest of the epsilon. Okay? So this is for finite. 0. But this is this set of symbols that those letters could be a bit more. Okay, very well. So, I once again remind you that all of this is under this assumption, the domain of definition of our function is contains at least some neighborhood of x0, this neighborhood. Once again, I note that nowhere here we care about the value of the function at x0. So, the function may be not even defined at x0 because we have a deleted neighborhood. Over here, we ask x to be from deleted neighborhood string, so it should not be x0. And over there, xn should not be x0. So, nowhere here we care about the value of our function at the point of 0 itself. It's important. Okay, now we have two definitions of the same object. Now we want to see if those definitions are different. There. About two definitions. Limit of a function f of x equals a as x tends to x0 for Cauchy. Of this function is a for a. So I'm going to prove that those two definitions are equivalent. So if some function has some limit, according to one of those definitions, it has the same limit according to the other. Okay. Proof. Let f of x tend to a 0 over Cauchy. So now I'm going to write down this definition. But usually in this definition of a limit of a sequence, we used let epsilon as the number that is greater than zero. But now I'm going to use the which is also like a legend. It's just some positive. So, I'm writing down for a delta greater than zero, there exists capital L such that for any L greater than capital L, it follows. Usually we write down that xn minus x0 less than delta, we would write it down. But here I want to write it as a neighborhood. So I will write down that xn is from neighborhood size delta. And also noting that the sequence should not attain x0 over here, we can write here a deleted neighborhood size delta of x0. Now, this number n depends on the previous numbers, specifically on delta, and I will denote it like that. We sometimes use this notation. It doesn't change anything, I'm just emphasizing that it depends on delta. Okay, let's go on. Now, for any epsilon greater than zero, I will take that delta from the Cauchy's definition. delta from the chain sequence. Such that for any n greater than that n delta, for any n greater than n delta, we have xn from this to this neighborhood. For any n greater than n delta, we have xn from this to this neighborhood. And for any x from this same to this neighborhood, we have that f of x from this neighborhood, from epsilon neighborhood of a. So we write, it follows that x m is from deleted delta neighborhood of zero, which implies that f of x is from epsilon neighborhood of A. So let's read this like that. For any epsilon greater than 0, there exists a number such that for any n greater than this number, f of x is from over x n. F of xn is from epsilon neighborhood of A. That means that the limit of f of xn as n tends to infinity is A. Hence, the limit function f of x as x tends to 0 equals a more than a. So I've proven this theorem one way. If a function has some specific limit following Cauchy's definition, then this function has the same limit following Hegel's definition. Okay. Now we will prove converse. I have proven that if a function has a limit following Cauchy, then it has the same limit following Hegel. So now I'm going to prove that if a function does not have the limit A following Cauchy, then it would not have the same, that limit A following Hegel. So I proved that from the definition of the limit following Cauchy follows the definition following Hegel. Now I'm going to prove that if the definition following Cauchy does not hold, then the definition following Hegel also does not hold. So I'm writing approximately like this. Let A not be a limit of our function or Cauchy. There exists epsilon greater than zero, such that for any delta greater than zero, there exists x from that deleted delta neighborhood of x zero, such that f of x is not from epsilon neighborhood of A. So this is the negation of Cauchy's definition. Now, for any natural pattern, let delta be equal to 1 over n. And for this delta, it says there exists such epsilon. Okay, very well. Now, for any delta, something happens. Now, let delta be this number. This is a positive number. Now, for this specific number delta, there exists a number x. X. There exists x. Since this depends on this size of delta, I will call it xn. So for different numbers n, for different natural numbers, they may be different x's. So there exists xn from this deleted 1 over n of neighborhood of x0. So delta equals 1 over n, so it's a delta, right? 1 over n. There exists such xn, such that f of xn is not from epsilon. Constructed xn such that xn is from deleted 1 over n neighborhood of x0. Then a sequence xn is sequence at x0. So the distance from xn to x0 is less than 1 over n, and xn, so xn tends to x0, and xn does not attain x0 since it's from the deleted neighborhood. So this is a Heaney sequence. Now, constructed this sequence xn such that f of xn is not from epsilon neighborhood of A. So I'm going to write it down like that. For any n at all, it follows that f of xn is not from epsilon neighborhood of A. Very well. Now, this is already a good enough statement, but I will fill it a bit to make it look what I want to make it look. So I'm going. This is true for any natural n, but I will write it like that. Okay, so once again, I have proven that if some number is the limit of a function f following Cauchy, then it is the limit following Hamming. And I have proven that if some number is not the limit following Cauchy, then this is not the limit following Hamming. Okay, very well. Now, could you tell me what was the definition that I gave you for the delete neighborhood? Was there delta or 1 over delta? Delete neighborhood, I want to know about the delete neighborhood.
Delta.
Just delta. Yes, one. Yes, everywhere here, deleted neighborhood of x0 is deleted with the dot, and neighborhood of A is not deleted without the dot. Guys, I have realized that this proof would not work as smoothly for neighborhoods of infinity. So I'm giving you a new definition of neighborhood of infinity. Deleted neighborhood, delta neighborhood of plus infinity. This will also be just neighborhood of plus infinity. And this will be a set of numbers. basically I'm just putting one over delta instead of delta there. Since delta is a positive number, it kind of doesn't matter. I could put one over delta, delta doesn't matter. But this way, my proof for this theorem works universally for all of the symbols. There exists a limit as x tends to 0 of f of x plus g of x. This limit equals 0. There exists a limit as x tends to 0. There exists a limit as x tends to 0 of f of x divided by g of x, and this limit is a divided by b. Provide that the denominator doesn't turn to 0.
I think you have to write the g of x.
G of x, of course. Thank you. G of x,
thank you.
This was a 10. Here it was g of x. Provided that b is not 0 and there exists a neighborhood. Zero same as Paul's equals A. So this is a theorem similar to a theorem about three sequences, and we will call it a theorem about three functions. Let's write down definitions of limits of all functions that we have in this in those three theorems using Hayes' definition. This is not really a proof, this is an ideal proof, so this is the way to prove it. But I think you can see that this is obvious enough. So for example, let's take this theorem number 4. Let's write down definition of those limits following here. Since we have this inequality, we have the same inequality for f of x and g of x and a of x, then from the theorem of three sequences we have that g of x n tends to the same limit a. By definition, following here, this means that the limit of this function is a. And exactly the same way it could be proven the other two theorems. Okay. Next theorem needs proof. Okay. Theorem. And let also be true that there is a neighborhood. They exist. Delete neighborhood 0 such that for a x from this deleted neighborhood, it follows that g of x does not equal y 0. Let there be a limit f as y tends to y 0 of my function f of y. We'll call this limit z 0. So g tends to y 0 as f tends to x 0. F tends to z0 as y tends to y0, then there is a limit of f of g of x as x tends to z0, and this limit equals z0. Let's prove it. So, I'm writing down Cauchy's definition. Yeah, Cauchy's definition of this limit. Limit of f of y equals to 0, so y tends to y 0, means for a epsilon equal to 0, just the definition. Now let's write down this definition. Here we usually use letters epsilon and delta as positive numbers. Now I'm going to use different letters. So instead of epsilon, I will use letter delta, and instead of delta, I will use a new letter. So for any delta greater than 0, they exist. Gamma greater than 0, such that for any x from deleted gamma neighborhood of x0, it follows that g of x is from delta neighborhood of y0. Okay, g of x is from delta neighborhood of y0, but we also know that g of x does not equal y0. fixed the name of the truth. What is zero? It is from a neighborhood, but it's not y zero itself. Then this is from the little neighborhood. Okay, that's all. Now let's combine it. So I am combining those two, three statements, three lines. So for any epsilon grid material, there exists delta, and for any delta, there exists gamma. I will write there exists gamma greater than zero, such that for any x from deleted gamma neighborhood of x zero, it follows g is from deleted delta neighborhood y zero, and since g is from deleted delta neighborhood of y zero, hence y equals g of x is from deleted delta neighborhood of y zero, hence from this line f of y, which is f of g of x, is from epsilon neighborhood of z zero. But this just means that there exists a limit of f x as x tends to 0, and this limit is z0. That was theorem 5. Theorem 6. Cauchy's criterion. Similarly to Cauchy's criteria of existence of a limit of a sequence, we have a criterion for existence of an elliptical function. So let function f of x be defined in some deleted neighborhood of x. to put it two ways. Necessity is if there exists this limit, then this Cauchy's condition hold, and sufficiency the other way around. Necessity. Let's write down this definition. For A in epsilon exists, such as here, once again, using this trick, where instead of epsilon, I'm writing epsilon multiplied by some specific positive number. Since epsilon is any positive number, epsilon divided by 2 is also any positive number. Okay, so let's write down this statement for those two numbers, x1 and x2. So x1 is some number from this deleted neighborhood, and for any number from this deleted neighborhood, this expression holds. So this first term is less than epsilon divided by 2, and similarly the second term is less than epsilon divided by 2, which just seems. So for any epsilon such that for any x1 and x2 from this deleted data neighborhood of x0, f x1 minus f of x2 is less than epsilon. So this is the Cauchy's condition. So I prove this necessity. If there exists a limit, then Cauchy's condition holds. The second